Matushka, Little Mother, is what the Russians affectionately call the Volga River, their nation's symbol. Russia's entire history is written in its rivers, and the route followed by our boat, the Dostoevsky, would allow us to discover some of its finest chapters. Departing from Moscow, capital of Central Russia, gateway to the east, we'll sail on rivers, glide down canals, and cross lakes, up to St. Petersburg, capital of the north, and turned towards the west. Though linked by waterways, the two cities are separated by history. Moscow, the religious capital, cradle of leading Russian thought, grew to the unhurried tempo of generations. St. Petersburg, museum city, resting place of the last czars and cradle of the Bolshevik Revolution, was the vision of one man, Peter the Great. On board one of the many river cruise boats that sail along the Moskva River, we enter the heart of the capital. We sail by more than mere monuments, actual symbols of Russian history. The Kremlin's red brick walls and the cathedral's golden domes remind us that for close to eight centuries, Moscow combined military might and religious supremacy. It took Soviet atheism to upset this balance. Sign of the times, the rebuilding of a monastery Stalin had ordered razed to erect the Palace of the Soviets, a 420-meter tower. But the project was abandoned and the Muscovites inherited an open-air swimming pool. During the Cold War years of the 50s, skyscrapers soared in the Moscow sky, both an assertion of Soviet power and an architectural expression of the opposition with the United States. These skyscrapers were all topped by spires designed by Stalin himself. Today, they're an integral part of Moscow's landscape. The huge Lomonosov State University building is the archetype of this kind of architecture, with gigantic sculptures and a 239-meter spire, topped by the Bolshevik star. Three Station Square, a daily stream of passengers pour in from Russia's interior, as well as a horde of peasant women who have come from surrounding areas to pocket a few rubles at this makeshift market. People sell what they can, cold meats, cakes, vegetables, even bootleg vodka. Red Square evokes military parades in the color of the communist flag, yet its name in Old Russian simply means beautiful and red. In the past, the square was a true forum and market. In the 16th century, stylish Moscow women came here to buy beauty products.
What people like the most is to have their picture taken in front of St. Basil's. They even pose in front of the GUM, as if they were in Venice, in Italy.
In the 19th century, Russia takes a modern turn and merchants set up shop under the huge glass-roofed arcades of the Upper Trading Rows, which became the GUM State Department Store in 1921. In a revival of the original purpose, the galleries today only stock leading brands and luxury merchandise. Red Square is a commercial hub and a place where homage is made to popular cult figures. For decades, endless processions of devotees have come to pay their respects to Lenin and the mausoleum that bears his name. Basil the Blessed, also a church of the people since it's situated outside the Kremlin walls, commemorates Russia's deliverance from the Mongol yoke. Tsar Ivan the Terrible, who commissioned the church in the mid-16th century, wanted an edifice like none other. It's an architectural fantasy of shapes, colors, and materials, with its main belfry 57 meters high, flanked by nine chapels, each topped with a different bulb-shaped dome. Faceted, ribbed, figured, or rainbow-colored, Basil the Blessed is the masterpiece of masterpieces. The Kremlin became a genuine fortified town in the 15th century, housing palaces and cathedrals, as battles ensued against the Mongol horde. Topped by a ruby star, the famous Savior's Tower, 71 meters high, marks the noblest and most sacred entrance to the Kremlin. It's said that the Tsar himself had to remove his headdress before taking the path to Cathedral Square. Originating in Byzance, Eastern Christianity spread throughout Russia. Once it became highly influential, the Orthodox Church decided to make Moscow the country's religious seat. In the heart of the Kremlin, the secular and the sacred joined to create an unusually fine architectural ensemble. The Assumption Cathedral, where coronations were held, was built in 1475. It combines the simplicity of wooden churches with the refined Italian Renaissance tradition. Though the Assumption was Russia's main church, the tiny Cathedral of the Annunciation, built in 1484 and nicknamed the Cathedral with the Golden Roofs, was a chapel for Moscow's princes and the Tsars. Soaring over Cathedral Square is the belfry of Ivan the Great, 81 meters high, used as a lookout tower. The upper drum is girded with a gilded inscription that gives thanks to the Tsar and the Holy Trinity in Slavonic Old Russian. Amidst the cathedrals rose the Tsar's early palaces. Russian architects had not yet mastered stone masonry techniques. In 1491, an Italian built the Palace of Facets, whose walls are sculpted in rectangular, faceted shapes. Many centuries later, Tsar Nicholas I commissioned the Great Palace, which houses over 700 rooms, one of which is the famous St. George Hall, dedicated to Russia's most prestigious order. Here in the palace's largest ceremonial hall, whose walls are inscribed with more than 10,000 names of officers and generals, were held the greatest receptions of the Tsarist Empire and the USSR era. Komsomolskaya Station. Marble columns, chandeliers, and mosaics. Moscow's subway, inaugurated in 1935, was to be the People's Palace. When the symbols of the new Russia encounter those of the former USSR. Vedenskaya Park, literally the exhibition of national economic achievements, was designed in the 50s to glorify agricultural and scientific success in the ex-USSR. Cult items are still present. The statue of Lenin against a gold star. The fountain of friendship between the peoples. The rocket Vostok, standing in front of the Cosmos Pavilion. The new shopping-conscious Muscovites seem oblivious to all of this as they rush to buy Japanese products. And And as the sculpture, the worker in the Kolkhoz woman, offers the sight of two people petrified by a curse of some kind, Russia enjoys itself and marvels at the circus. Our boat slowly leaves for Moscow. On sultry summer days, the canal banks are literally besieged. On board, the commander welcomes the passengers. We pass through our first lock as the water and sky turn golden in the twilight. By morning, we're on the Volga River.
We turned after the Kachino Bridge. Now we're moving straight ahead towards the church.
The bell tower, set on an isle in the middle of the river, once overlooked the village of Kalyazin, which, like many others, was flooded when the dam was built on the Volga River. As we go through each lock, our boat descends a dozen meters, nearing sea level and St. Petersburg. In the Middle Ages, Uglich was a major stopover on the great Volga trade route. Travelers from Scandinavia stopped here to rest and repair their boats, while those from the east prepared to return up the river's upper course, pulling their crafts. Under Moscow's protection, the town expanded and numbered up to 10 monasteries, most of which are deserted today. But Uglich went down in history because of a mysterious event, the death of Dmitry, heir to the throne, son of Ivan the Terrible.
This is the church of the Tsarevich Dmitry. It's also called Bloodshed. It's where the little boy died. They say that when they brought his body to Moscow, a drop of blood fell, and the church was built on that spot.
Inside the church, topped by 5 blue cupolas dotted with gold stars, one for the Christ and 4 for the evangelists, a frieze surrounding a magnificent iconostasis recounts the story of Dmitry. Whether Boris Godunov ordered his murder, or whether he died from an epileptic fit, Dmitry's death remains a mystery to this day and has made him a saint and a myth. Our seeking adventurers, imposters sent by the Polish knights, a number of false Dimitris appeared, plunging the country into a long period of unrest. Cathedral of the Transfiguration. As in all Orthodox churches, there stands an iconostasis, a large panel of icons open for churchgoers to see, separating the nave from the sanctuary, only accessible to the priests. For the passengers and for the sailors, who call this section of the Volga tea, because the river is so deep here they can navigate easily while having tea. Long ago, pagan tribes settled on the riverbanks would attack the boats. Today, Yaroslav is a peaceful town, and the banks of the Volga have become a place for relaxation and leisure, especially on Sundays. Here, the peasant women at the Yaroslav market wear the traditional headscarves, and the market, like those in all Russian towns, is a traditional meeting place. For several years during the troubles caused by the death of Tsarevich Dmitry, the capital of Russia was moved to Yaroslav. The town then became the leading trade center of the Upper Volga. Dutch and English merchants settled here. In the early 17th century, 1/6 of the wealthiest Russian families owned homes in Yaroslav, which owes its name to its founder around the year 1000, Prince of Rostov, Yaroslav the Wise. The Transfiguration of Our Savior Monastery is a fine example of fortified architecture. From the belfry summit, beyond the cathedral's golden domes and monastery walls, we see the city and its many churches on the horizon. As the city grew in commercial strength, church after church was built to please God, the Orthodox Church, and also perhaps to rival Moscow. By the late 17th century, over 50 new churches had been constructed.
Решетки работают.
We meet Masha in the monastery gardens. She'd been living in the woods surrounding Yaroslav and was taken in when she was just a cub. A way to revive the legend, you might say.
The story is that Prince Yaroslav the Wise was sailing on the Volga, near here, and saw some people. But they were hostile towards him. They were pagans, and the bear was a god for them. They set a bear loose on the prince, but the prince, showing great bravery, killed the animal. This legend explains why a bear is part of the city's coat of arms.
Где-то улица, где-то дом, где-то барышня, что я влюблен. А вот эта улица, вот это дом, вот эта башня, что я
In 1952, Stalin, inaugurating the last link in the 5C waterway system, achieved Peter the Great's dream. Boats now sail effortlessly through gigantic locks. Do they remember, we may wonder, the famous Volga boatmen who hauled their crafts, giving themselves courage with sad, solemn songs? Numbering over 500,000 in the past century, these boatmen have now gone down in history. Like the 2,600 villages, 165 towns, and the millions of Gulag prisoners swallowed up in this gigantic project. After covering over 800 kilometers since leaving Moscow, we arrive in sight of the small village of Goritsy. Several miles outside Goritsy, we see the monastery of Kirillov, located on the banks of the White Lake. Time seems to have stood still in this corner of Russia, on these women with gestures from another era. In the 14th century, a wandering monk in search of spiritual fulfillment, Cyril, then 60 years old, decided to settle in Kirillov and build a monastery that later became the most powerful one in Russia. Centuries went by and the monastery fell into decline. Then came the revolution and oblivion, until a handful of young priests arrived.
Why did you come to this out-of-the-way deserted place?
It's simple. I was born here. I spent all my life here. The monastery was founded 600 years ago by Saint Cyril of the White Lake. He was an extraordinary man, both on a human and spiritual level, and many princes came to him to receive advice and his blessing.
How do you see Russia's spiritual future?
No matter who I talk to, they always ask the same question. I don't know what is best for the Christian faith. Times of persecution or times of calm and comfort. We had many martyrs at the turn of the century. Some have already been canonized. It's somewhat like the early centuries of Christianity when there was mass persecution.
Даже можно вспомнить первые христианские века, когда были такие очень сильные массовые гонения.
As we cross the White Lake, the surface is rocked by swells stirred up by the north wind. We then sail into the Kovja River, part of the Volga-Baltic Canal. During the night, we pass through six locks and descend 80 meters on the way to Lake Onega. The boat draws close to Kiji. Strange shapes play hide and seek with the morning fog. We're in Karelia, where strange legends tell of mermaids, nymphs, and mischievous children.
Fishermen live here?
Yes, a lot. The fishermen live in the village of Yamka. That's over there. We're from Zarniki. A lot of fishermen live here too, and we even go out ourselves. Today, Boris and Ivan are going to throw out the net.
It always gets tangled up.
The island of Kiji is actually a huge open-air museum of wooden monuments from the Lake Onega region. The children, whose parents work for the museum, only live here during the summer. In winter, when the lake freezes over, they return to the town of Petrozavodsk. These men in charge of security built a hut in pine logs and set up their banya, their steam bath, a northern Russian institution. One of them puts together veniks, bundles of birch branches used to strike the body and stimulate circulation.
I've just gone around all the monuments to inspect the fire extinguishers. Our job is mainly prevention. We patrol, stay on the lookout, check things out, give advice.
The masterpiece Ankiji is the Cathedral of the Transfiguration, with a monochrome, though striking, design that could have been dreamed up by a science fiction artist. The 22 cupolas of the cathedral, built in 1714, are covered with 30,000 shingles, wood roofing tiles, made of aspen to withstand the cold. It was built using secular techniques without screws or nails by a carpenter named Nestor. The story goes that once he'd placed the final shingle, he threw his axe into Lake Onega, shouting, "There never was, and there never will be another one like it." Leaving Lake Onega, we sail into the Zvir River, which meanders through the Karelia forests. The arrival of a cruise boat is quite an attraction in this humble village on the banks of the Zvir, and a number of inhabitants, some of whom come from quite a distance, touchingly try to earn a few rubles, or better yet, a few dollars.
Thank you.
During the day, we had the pleasure of sharing a few moments with the family that welcomed us with open arms in their dacha, their summer house. But above all, it was a delight to meet Vera Pavlovna, the grandmother, the babushka.
What is your role in the family?
They couldn't do a thing without me. I do everything, both the men and the women's work. Everything. I do all the supervising.
What does the word babushka mean to you?
Babushka. I don't know. For them, babushka is everything. I devote myself to them. I live just for them, and they respect me. I've never heard them say anything mean. Marina calls me Babenka. He calls me Babushka. What does it mean? I don't know. I love them. They adore me. What else can I say?
At the northernmost end of Lake Onega, hidden in the heart of Valam Island, in a dense forest, cut off from the rest of the world as if to test the religious fervor of followers and visitors, inaccessible and mysterious, we discover the Monastery of the Transfiguration, one of the most sacred sites for the Orthodox Church. In 1940, Stalin closes the monastery. Taking advantage of perestroika, the first monks in exile in Finland returned in 1989, bringing new life to the monastery. In a region that boasts over 100 million devotees and 54,000 parishes, Valam regains its place and status, namely among young people attracted to religion.
I think the basis of the Orthodox religion is to honor Jesus' original values. None of this is new. Only the outer aspects have evolved. The churches, the clothing, the icons, and other aspects of spiritual life. But the core remains the same. Most of the brothers come from large cities, Moscow and St. Petersburg. Naturally, we go back into town from time to time. Not very often, but occasionally. When we get back here, it's like being back in Eden.
After the monastery doors close behind Igumen the Superior and the monks in the community, silence once again reigns supreme on the mysterious island of Valam. The Neva, Fontanka, and Moika canals are the pulse of St. Petersburg. As we enter the city, we come a little closer to its soul. All that remains to be told is its history. In the marshy delta of the Neva River, in the Gulf of Finland facing Europe, Peter the Great decided to build his new capital in 1703. On a tiny isle, construction work begins on the Peter Paul Fortress. Abandoning the cupola tradition, Peter the Great chose a positively European style for the Peter Paul Cathedral occupying the center of the fortress, with a bell tower topped by a golden spire. Inside the cathedral, whose Baroque decor clashes with the simple facade, are buried all the tsars of the Romanov dynasty, except Nicholas II, executed with his family in 1918. Apart from the sepulchres for Alexander II and his wife, sculpted in colored stone, the tombs of the other tsars are in white marble, with an imperial eagle adorning each corner. Would Peter the Great, known for his bad temper, have appreciated the contemporary artistic caricature? We doubt it. However, 250 years after his death, Peter has become a hot-selling marketing item. Tourists have their picture taken next to a look-alike, and on display in a souvenir shop is a model of his first boat. Thank you. After a number of trips abroad, Peter the Great decided that Russia's future lay with Europe. A huge man, 2 meters tall, Peter was also an inquisitive, cultured person, a collector, a ruler of many interests, including ship's carpentry, which he learned in Holland. Although his city was built by Italians, Englishmen, and Frenchmen, he named it Sankt Peterburg. A gigantic wind-measuring apparatus with 3 dials linked to the weather vane out of scientific curiosity. Blue ceramic stove inspired by Delft, decorated with boats because of his love of the sea. In his humble summer palace, Peter recreated the peaceful, austere atmosphere of the Holland he loved and was so fond of. St. Petersburg, considered too Germanic a name, was Russianized as Petrograd on the eve of World War I, then Leningrad after the October Revolution and the death of its leader. St. Petersburg, considered too aristocratic, lost its rank as capital to Moscow, a move that undoubtedly saved the city from Stalin's skyscrapers.
Is there such a thing as Russian music?
Certainly. Not only does it exist now, it existed before and will continue to exist. I think Russian music is as eternal as Russia itself, and like everything connected to our country. What's interesting here in St. Petersburg is that the people did not influence the city. It was the city that influenced the people. Although Peter the Great, the founder, wanted the city to be European, what happened here is absolutely extraordinary. It's a magical place.
Peter the Great's successors continued to beautify the city. Palace Square, Baroque and classical styles harmonize and exalt each other instead of clashing. The 2 purely neoclassical buildings designed by Rossi sit in a semicircle on one side of the square, while on the other side, simply separated by the tallest monolith column in the world, erected in memory of Alexander I, Napoleon's conqueror, stands the Winter Palace, Rastrelli's Baroque masterpiece. Color in order to dynamize shapes, Rastrelli uses blue, his favorite color, in the Smolny Convent and St. Nicholas of the Sailors' Church, for which he also designed golden cupolas. Peterhof, which means Peter's Court, brings us back once again to the founded Tsar, who chose the site of this summer palace himself, facing the Gulf of Finland. According to a tradition of unknown origin, newlyweds lay a bouquet of flowers at the foot of the statue of Peter the Great, supposedly for good luck. St. Petersburg honors its navy. The rostral columns are lit as they were during the times when they were used as beacons to guide the ships into the Neva. The drawbridges over the Neva are raised in the middle of the day, exceptionally for the occasion. Ironically, The cruiser Aurora was blocked in by the Neva drawbridges, which remained closed on that famous day of 1917. Unable to come closer, they fired blanks at the Winter Palace, giving the attack signal to the revolutionaries. We cannot leave St. Petersburg without visiting the Hermitage Museum. Located in the Winter Palace, it houses one of the most astonishing collections of European paintings one will ever see. The Dutch Rembrandt is placed next to the Italian Da Vinci. In other galleries, French painters and Russian masters hang side by side. Renoir, the Impressionist, accompanies an imperial carriage. And Cézanne, the forerunner, precedes Picasso, the Cubist. As the doors of the Hermitage close slowly behind Matisse's dancers, outside the sun sets ablaze the finest monuments of the Neva, lending a final touch to an exceptional picture, St. Petersburg.